"Don't you dare laugh," warned Anne in a whisper as they marched along the newspapers, "and I implore you, Diana, not to look at me, no matter what she says, or I shall not be able to keep a sober face." The papers extended across the hall and into a prim, fleckless parlor. Anne and Diana sat down gingerly on the nearest chairs and explained their errand. Mrs. White heard them politely, interrupting only twice, once to chase out an adventurous fly, and once to pick up a tiny wisp of grass that had fallen on the carpet from Anne's dress. Anne felt wretchedly guilty, but Mrs. White subscribed $2 and paid the money down. "To prevent us from having to go back for it," Diana said when they got away. Mrs. White had the newspapers gathered up before they had their horse untied, and as they drove out of the yard, they saw her busily wielding a broom in the hall. "I've always heard that Mrs. Theodore White was the neatest woman alive, and I'll believe it after this," said Diana, giving way to her suppressed laughter as soon as it was safe. "I am glad she has no children," said Anne solemnly. "It would be dreadful beyond words for them if she had." At the Spencers, Mrs. Isabella Spencer made them miserable by saying something ill-natured about everyone in Avonlea. Mr. Thomas Boulter refused to give anything because the hall, when it had been built 20 years before, hadn't been built on the site he recommended. Mrs. Esther Bell, who was the picture of health, took half an hour to detail all her aches and pains, and sadly put down 50 cents, because she wouldn't be there that time next year to do it. No, she would be in her grave. Their worst reception, however, was at Simon Fletcher's. When they drove into the yard, they saw two faces peering at them through the porch window, but although they rapped and waited patiently and persistently, nobody came to the door. Two decidedly ruffled and indignant girls drove away from Simon Fletcher's. Even Anne admitted that she was beginning to feel discouraged. But the tide turned after that. Several Sloane homesteads came next, where they got liberal subscriptions, and from that to the end they fared well with only an occasional snub. Their last place of call was at Robert Dixon's by the Pond Bridge. They stayed to tea here, although they were nearly home, rather than risk offending Mrs. Dixon, who had the reputation of being a very touchy woman. While they were there, old Mrs. James White called in. "I've just been down to Lorenzo's," she announced. "He's the proudest man in Avonlea this minute. What do you think? There's a brand new boy there, and after 7 girls that's quite an event, I can tell you." Anne pricked up her ears, and when they drove away she said, "I'm going straight to Lorenzo White's."
"But he lives on the White Sands Road, and it's quite a distance out of our way," protested Diana. "Gilbert and Fred will canvass him."
"They are not going around until next Saturday, and it will be too late by then," said Anne firmly. "The novelty will be worn off. Lorenzo White is dreadfully mean, but he will subscribe to anything just now. We mustn't let such a golden opportunity slip, Diana."